not able to come. You know, sometimes people don't understand. They think, well, I don't feel well, I'm going to stay home today. But, you know, coming to the house of God will help you get well.
Amen.
Feeling his presence. Amen.
Amen.
So many times I have come and just, I could have stayed in the bed, much less stayed at home. But God is able to come and work.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
God bless you. Amen. All right, we're going to the word. Then the Lord says to tell you to read Deuteronomy 8 for 90 days.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father. That's right.
Did he struggle and strive, or did he labor?
he labored in prayer. That was where the labor comes in. The labor doesn't come in you trying to make something happen. The labor comes in through your prayer and seeking God.
Amen.
Everybody runs into contrary winds from time to time. We all do. We run into contrary winds, really contrary winds. I was thinking the other day when we were at the service where we were called to preach on Thursday. Everybody introduced me, and he introduced me, and he was saying all that I was. I was a mother, and I was an aunt, and so forth. And then he said I was a songwriter, and I said, no, wait a minute. Because I did, the Lord gave me a song just recently, and I gave it to him. But then I went and looked in all my things in 1954. I thought about it, and I said, oh, that was one of the first songs I had.
I know.
And I was thinking, that I just want to tell, this is a testimony, but I was in my kitchen, and as I was saying, we weren't poor, we was poor. You know, we just really didn't have money. And my husband was working every day, but we were putting it all into what we were striving to get done. Struggling and striving. Going, struggling and striving. And we thought, I guess, that it was up to us. Well, we didn't think that. We thought it was the Lord's doing, but we thought we had to put all the money in because nobody else put it in. So there weren't that many people to put it in, this little small church back in Ohio. But anyhow, my washing machine went out of whack. And then something else went out of whack. And you know how that goes. One thing after another. And you don't have money harder to eat. So you sure don't have money to get any new appliances. But I started to say, I was just getting fed up. I started to say, one of these days we're going to have some money. That's what I was starting to say. And instead of saying that, I said, one of these days, I'm going to see my Savior's face. One of these days, I'm going to see my Savior's face. I'm going to view the Lamb. I'm going to view the Lamb one of these days.
Hallelujah.
And I'm going to walk the streets one of these days. I'm going to walk the streets. And I found that old piece of paper. I got the see how? 1954 by Gracecuv. I guess I have a song. And then I found a few more.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah.
And you probably sang one of them, which was you don't have to slave the family anymore. But anyhow.
Throw me overboard, I got a hiding place?
No. But it doesn't matter. But there was several more. And I began to count them up. I said, oh, we got about 5 or 6 songs here. But anyhow, we were struggling and striving. Huh. But in the meantime, we put some water. I filled up the washing machine with water. And I looked, and on top of the machine, there was a dollar bill floating. Now that, I know that doesn't mean very much to you, because you can't do nothing with a dollar bill now, huh? But in those
54?
Days,
amen.
You could buy a pound of sugar, a gallon of milk, and a dozen of eggs, all with $1. About 25 cents for your eggs, 18 cents for the milk. Well, anyhow, a dollar meant a whole lot of money. And I saw this dollar float on top of the washing machine. And I told my husband, oh, I got so excited about this dollar, and so then, and I went and showed him the dollar, And so I went back to the washing machine and there was another dollar floating. And I said, here's another one. And he said, well, where'd it come from? I said, I don't know. And he came, and when we looked, there was another one. We ended up with four $1 bills, wow, which was buy enough groceries almost for the whole week.
Wow. All right, Jesus!
And I put them in the oven to dry. I didn't keep them in the oven to let them dry out, and they were new and crisp. I have no idea to this day where those dollars came from.
Thank you, Jesus.
I have an idea, but you wouldn't believe my idea. But anyhow, what I'm trying to tell you is sometimes you're struggling and you're striving. But God wants you to let Him do it. And it is so hard for us to lay down our heavy load and say, Lord, you take it. But the Apostle Paul said, I labored abundantly more than you hoped.
Hallelujah.
In other words, I was praying, I've been seeking God, and I've been working hard to get souls into the kingdom.
Yes.
So you're struggling and you're striving to make a living is not what God wants you to do.
How about seeking?
Your job is not for you to make a living.
Jesus.
That's not what your job is for.
Jesus.
Your job is for you to get to the place where God can help you.
My Eloshatarabasa.
I don't know whether you understand.
I understand. Thank you, Jesus.
And it's so that you can help the kingdom.
Yes.
And when you start praying and helping the kingdom,
Jesus,
then the kingdom will come.
Amen. Amen. Jesus.
Halabasu.
Yes.
In the the scripture says the harvest is ripe, the laborers are few. And so what he's saying is, you're struggling and striving, but you're struggling and striving for the wrong purpose. Your work ought to be to get people into the kingdom. That's supposed to be your work. Your labor ought to be to get right with God.
Right.
Get your heart right.
Right.
Now, when the disciples were, the theme was, they were straining and rowing, right? They were trying to get to where they were going, and they were straining, but they weren't getting nowhere. So you've been trying to get where you think you want to go for a long time. Have you got there yet? You haven't got there, have you? So why don't you quit and let God take you where He wants to take you?
Amen.
You've been straining and rowing. When they saw Jesus, can I just take my time?
Please. When they Holy saw Ghost, talk Jesus, to me.
They cried out. Do you hear what I'm saying?
Yes.
They cried out to God. See, we think, I don't have time to pray.
Jesus.
If you don't have time to pray, you don't even have time to go to work. You don't have time to cook. You don't have time to do nothing else if you don't have time to pray.
That's it.
You think you got to make a living, and that's not what God wants. If I could only get across some of the things that God has done in my life to help me to do His will,
Jesus,
and not mine.
Hallelujah.
And He provides for me.
Amen.
It's not a boast, but it is a boast in Christ. Do you know, for the last 50 years, I had not had to, or my husband didn't have to buy me clothes. Say, well, what do you do? Well, God put it on some people's hearts.
Yes.
Kelly needs some clothes. It's my nickname. I don't want you to call me that. Grace. You. So they send Kelly boxes. Every year, I get at least one or two boxes. It started with my mother. And then my sister took it up. And then her daughter took it up. And now, practically everything that I wear, I don't have to go shopping for. Now, you say, well, why is that? Well, do you like wearing, do Yep, I love what I get. Some of it's new and some of it's not. But it's all nice stuff.
Amen.
Ooh, Jesus. But when they saw Jesus, they stopped what they were doing.
Hallelujah.
And cried out to him. Because they knew he could get them where to go. And immediately when he got in the boat, they were at where they were supposed to be. Immediately. Do you hear what I'm saying?
Yes, yes.
It didn't take them no time. Now you've been trying for 25 years. Your 401k. I was listening to a program that said how to live in America. And this is a religion program. Now this is what you're supposed to do. Pay your tithes. Of course, I've done that all my life. Pay your tithes. But they said, then after you pay your tithes, you're supposed to pay yourself. I've never been able to do that. And then, put in your 401k. I've never had a 401k. I don't even know what one looks like. Say, well, have you ever worked? Yes. I worked on public jobs, but I didn't have a 401k. I've had about three or four public jobs. What you call public, I guess it's public or private, whatever. No 401ks. If you knew, I could tell you the whys of all that. A couple of them was pretty good jobs, but no 401k. So I couldn't put into my 401k, but I put into my 401k. I don't know what that means. That means tithe. Ten is tithe. If people would learn to tithe.
Come on, Jesus. Come on, Jesus. Holy Ghost, talk to me. Hallelujah.
If you learn to tithe, your money, your 90% of your money would go further.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Come on, Jesus. Holy Ghost, talk to me.
Scared that you're not going to have enough. You hold your tithe back. And what is $1 out of 10 going to help you do that 9 can't help you do? Amen. You understand? Tithe is 10, right? So that's $1 out of 10. So how is 1 going to help you better than 10? Do you get that? Does that make sense? I'm not telling you because I need anything because I'm fixed.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
I didn't say grace comes, I said God.
Thank you, Father.
But I couldn't live on what grace comes provides, and I appreciate it. Don't think I don't. God knows I do. But I couldn't live off of that. There's no way in the world. We don't even go there. But anyhow.
Thank you, Father.
The point is, we are so fearful we don't trust God. But if we could see God,
Holy Ghost, talk to me.
If we could see God, we would say, Lord, you can have 20%.
Which Amen.
Is what I do with what I get. I have to do that. I tried to back up, it didn't work. Amen. I have to get 20%.
Thank you, Father.
Oh, God. Because I don't want to live my whole life struggling and striving.
Jesus.
And going, trying to make it to land, and I'm not getting nowhere. You just
come on
roll,
now.
You're rolling and rolling, and you're in the same place.
Thank you, Father.
You're just rolling and rolling, trying to make it.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father.
Maybe they're never going to meet. They're never going to meet. I assure you they will never meet because you haven't done what God told you to do.
Come on now.
Oh, Jesus.
Talk to me, Holy Ghost.
In Matthew, the 14th chapter, we talk about the two fish and the 5 loaves. And this is what God had already done. He had already provided for 5,000 people with 2 fish. In fact, why do you think God put that in the Bible?
So we'll know he's
provided. So to let you know
Amen.
What he is able to do.
Hallelujah.
Give it to God. Say, Lord, I don't know what to do. Help me. Some of you probably need to attend the
class.
The class that L.A. Eubanks teaches. And you'll learn how to you know, through your finances. Because you can make it.
Amen.
And you can make it on so much. You know, sometimes I just look at money and think, where did this come from?
Amen. Ah, yeah.
How did I do that? How can I do this? And it's nothing but God.
Amen.
But anyhow, he said to in Matthew, that same passage where they were rowing, trying to make it to shore.
Hallelujah.
Jesus said, they need not depart. Said, and then the Lord said to me, you have everything you need. In other words, he asked Philip, he said, how are we going to feed these people? And the scripture says he knew what he was going to do.
Amen.
The Lord knew what he was going to do. But he asked Philip, how? You know, when God asks a question, he already got the answer.
Amen.
And he said, Philip, how will we feed the people? And they said, well, Lord, we would have to work a half a year. And still we wouldn't have enough to feed these 5,000 folks. And so the Lord said, well, what do you have? Like, what do you have? You got 10 bucks. And all I need is one of them. All I need is one out of 10. That's all I need. And he took those two fish and five loaves of... Do you think this is just a fairy tale?
No.
He took those two fish, five loaves of bread, and fed 5,000 people. Because he multiplied. Do you know God knows how to multiply? I told you about the money coming out of in the washing machine. God knows how to multiply. I remember I was looking in our cabin one time. When this child about 13 years old. Remember the old cabins we had where we canned all those peaches and plums and stuff? And I looked in the cabin and there was nothing there, really. Nothing. You know, when you say there's nothing there, you got beans and rice and you've got some canned goods. No, I'm like, we didn't have that. There might have been some peaches and plums in some canned jars that we canned. But I looked and the scripture said, the Egyptians that you see today, you'll see them no more forever.
Ha!
Don't understand,
child.
What he was talking about, lack of food was an enemy for us.
Yes.
We had at that time six kids. And daddy and I.
Huh.
There's eight people in the house.
Yes.
And plums that you got out of the tree in your can last year wasn't going to get it. You understand?
Yes.
But the Lord said, these are the, you see today, you won't see them. We'll talk about empty cabinets.
Right.
Shortly after that, God told my husband, he said, Rabbi, said, you know, I got this farm here, and you can just go and get, that's another thing we're going to do from the farm, just get all you want. And you don't have to, you know, it's like you pick, but you don't have to pay nothing. We got the boys and everybody out there. We pick corn, green beans. I don't know what all, I don't remember. But I know it's corn and green beans and tomatoes, whatever. Filled up the freezer that we had, because my mother had bought a freezer, which we just got rid of last year because I brought it here after I moved. It lasted for 50-some years.
Wow, look at God.
We filled that freezer up, and then we told the saints, filled up her refrigerator and filled up to the castle, her name was Castle, filled up her refrigerator with corn. Everybody that, we had about 15 people in the church, everybody's freezer, we filled it up and ours. Can God lie?
He cannot.
I'm talking about we were struggling, rolling, trying to make it, trying to feed the kids. Now, if you don't work, then you don't eat. So you need to go get a job. That's right. For real, you really need to get a job. If you don't have a job, then you forget about it. You just fast until you get one. Because Bobby was working. He was a hard working man. He worked 3 jobs, but we still was broke. How many of you got 6 kids? And then how many of you got 8 in your family to feed now? You got 8? Anybody got 8 to feed? Yeah. You got 1. You got 8 to feed. God will make a way. I tell you, because he made a way for us.
Thank you, Father.
To eat until we had plenty of food. And since that time, he's made a way. Ever since that, when I opened that thing, and he said, hey, did you see that? You won't see it no more? Can I just use the vernacular eye and see them?
All right, Jesus. That's my Jesus.
I have more food to eat than I need. You can probably tell. I get on the scales, I keep getting on. I need to throw them scales away. Because I keep getting on the scales every time I get on there, I lost a pound. I said, I'm trying to lose some pounds. Oh, Jesus, because I'm just eating. But I'm hungry. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Let me move on. Oh, Lord, have mercy. He says you don't need to depart. In other words, you don't need to go on your own trying to make it.
Amen.
Ask God what you should do.
Amen.
Ask God what you should do with your finance. Ask him, I don't care if you don't have but $25. Lord, what shall I do with this $25? And I guarantee you God will direct you and show you what you ought to do.
Amen.
He said you need not depart. Are you tired of pushing? Are you tired of struggling?
Sabbath.
Are you tired of striving? You know, legalism is one of the things that shifts your attention and your confidence from the personhood of God to yourself. What I mean by legalism is that means you doing what the world tells you to do. You know, like I tell you, the world said, you know, pay yourself. No, don't pay yourself first. Pay God first. Then pay yourself, and then pay your bills.
Huh.
But the third thing is, don't be making bills. Why you gonna make a bill if you know you don't have enough money to pay? Probably somebody gonna pay them $150 a month, and you don't even have $100 left after you pay your house note and your lights and your gas. So how you gonna pay? And some of us are too proud to say, you know, I'm telling you about I don't have to buy clothes. And I said, man, I don't buy my own clothes. Well, go ahead. Get in there. Go to Nordstrom. Let them have all your money.
Holy Ghost, talk to me.
Yeah, I talk to everybody. No, there's no money. Who the boy is it? Well, let Sears, whoever. I don't know who you buy from. Let Macy's, I know they're in business. I saw them a few days ago. Look, I know somewhere to buy my powder and makeup. Oh, bless them. But listen, you know, I was thinking, this morning, I mean, God is something else. He let me see something. I went to breakfast, where I, in the dining room where I live, this morning. And there was a lady finished. You know, we have a buffet for breakfast, and you go with your tray, and you get what you want, your own meal, your fruit, and your toast, and your waffle, whatever you want. And so this lady had finished her breakfast, and she was about to take her tray to the place where we put the dirty dishes in the tray. And so another lady came back that had already finished. She says, you want me to take your tray? And she says, no. And she was on a cane, so I guess the lady thought maybe, you know, she was unable. And so the lady would say, well, I can take it. No, I can take it. You know, and they was just, you know, like, I can do it. And in the meantime, here this guy comes up, takes the tray. Why are they still talking about it? I said, boy, that really fits into that message, because They talk about what they can do. And just takes it all over and puts it on. And this is the way God is.
Thank you, Father.
He loves you so much.
Yes, thank
he
you.
He wants to do it for you.
Hallelujah.
He wants to do
he
it for
wants
you.
To.
And you're over here arguing with yourself and your wife and your kids and whoever it is about, well, we can pay this and we can do this. And shut up and let God do it. That's right. Straining and growing. I'm going to be growing just a minute. Let's go forward.
Hallelujah.
Not depending on your own self. I told you that you got to work. But after you work, look at what you have and ask God how to use it.
Amen.
And then he said, you know, this book must not depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night. And he said in Isaiah, the 45th chapter, he said he blotted out our transgressions for his own sake. In other words, everything that he did for us, he did it for his own sake. Let me just give you an illustration. When a kid is walking with you and he's about 2 years old and he's tired, you pick him up and you carry him. Do you do that just for him? You do that for your own sake, because you love him and you know that he's tired and that he can't go much further.
Hallelujah.
And Jesus loves you. He knows you're tired. He knows you've been struggling. He knows you've been rolling, trying to make it.
Hallelujah.
But you're not going to make it on your own.
Wow.
You got to let God do it.
Wow.
Oh, Jesus.
Jesus.
He told Joshua, he said, I have already marked out your inheritance. I've already done it. And he said, no man will be able to overcome you. I know I cannot tell you where it is, but I know you got it. When the Lord told me you got everything you need, I could not see it, couldn't understand it. But I knew that that was God speaking.
Right.
Everything that I need, I already have it. When you say you already have it, by faith, I have it. I don't have to see it. I don't have to see it. If God said I have it, then I have it.
Right. Hey.
So you need to give God praise for I have it.
Hallelujah.
God. I'm thinking about this big guy that I just told you about. His name's Darrell. He lives around there. He picked up that tray and just carried it on between the ladies and took it on. I mean, it's not that it was that heavy, but it was heavy for the, you know, the lady. She did a cane and she couldn't hardly, you know, do it. So the other lady was going to try to help her. And we do the same thing. We try to help our kids and we try to help this one and that one and the other one. Just let it go. We got a big God. We got a big God. And he is able to do exceedingly.
Come on now. Come on now. Come on now.
That we can even ask for it.
There, that goes up.
According to the power that works in us. And the power that works in us is a step back. Say, okay, God, you got it. God, I don't know what to do with it, Lord.
Jesus, Jesus. Jesus.
We consider, you know, I'm going to try to put it. They did not, the scripture said the reason they were torn and roaring, they didn't consider the miracle of the two loaves and the five fish. So I want, this is the last thing I want to leave with you, is this. Consider what he's already done for you. Has God ever done anything for you that was miraculous?
Amen.
Ever?
Amen.
Ever?
Amen.
Just one thing. And you know it couldn't have been accomplished without the Lord. You just testify. You just testify. She went on a vacation. See, God even blesses you when you go on vacation. if you want him to. She could have gone on vacation and said, oh, well, we have a vacation, I don't have to go to church. But she was looking for a church. You know what I'm saying? She was looking for some friends that were saved. She could have gone 3 months. She could have done well. We don't know what she was doing there in Phoenix, Arizona. We don't know. But God knew her heart. And God provided. What I'm saying, just like he provided, you say, well, that is something different. No, 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 no different. He is able to do, I said, exceedingly abundantly above all that you can ask to think.
Thank you, Father.
Consider, and the reason, let me tell you this, the reason they didn't consider the loaves and the fish, the scripture says because their hearts were hardened.
Jesus.
Their hearts were hardened. That's what the word said. That's the reason they didn't consider. And we consider everything. We consider what the TV guy says. We consider what that little computer thing say. We consider everything except God. But listen to what God has said. And your freezers will be full. Resolve to live. Focus on what God can do and what he will do. And the reason he's going to do it, as I said, he does it for his own sake. Not because you're so good. Not because you're so good. Not because I'm so good. But because he loves you and you're his child. That's the reason he does it.
Hallelujah.
Because you belong to him. We consider our friends, our neighbors. We look at them, we say, oh, you know, they got it made. Honey, nobody has it made without Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Jesus.
Oh God.
Hallelujah, Father.
Somebody is struggling and striving this morning. And we want to pray with you that you will take your burdens to the Lord and leave them there. If the world from you withhold of its silver and it's gold, and you have to get along on meager fare, just remember in his word how he feeds the little bird. Take your burdens to the Lord. Leave it there. Finisher of our faith. And lift cup of our soul.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
Yes.
And we pray that you would just let the words of our mouth, the meditation of our heart, be acceptable in our
sight.
O Lord,
our strength and our redeemer.
Amen. Lord, bless you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.